Good morning, class. Today we are here with another lecture on first year chemistry. Today's topic is the next topic in the sixth chapter, which is, as you can see, the CHATELIER'S principle. I must first give you some background for this. If you remember, we started the sixth chapter 2 weeks ago. Today is our seventh lecture. And I have been telling you that there are two types of chemical reactions: the reversible reactions and the irreversible reactions. The irreversible reactions almost go to completion after some amount of time. However, reversible reactions continue to proceed. They have literally no completion. And at the beginning of this chapter, I have told you that our job as a student of chemistry is to control the direction of a reversible reaction. At that time, it might look very challenging to you. How can we control the direction of a chemical reaction? Do we have to jump into the vessel, jump into the container, and ask the molecules start go this way, that way? Of course not. I told you that we will not control. Some great scientists in the past history, they have done their research and they have found ways to actually control the direction of a reversible reaction. And Lee Chatelier, Henry Louise Chatelier, was the scientist who introduced methods for controlling the direction of reversible reactions. And the topic, the principle is of course named after him, because he was the one who discovered it. But it was much later, after his death, that his fellow scientists realized, or his students realized, that Lee Chatelier or Louise Chatelier should be honored. So this is again all about reversible reaction, and this principle is a guideline principle to basically control the direction of reversible reaction. Okay, so let's start this reaction, and let us first take a hypothetical reaction. Let us say we have a hypothetical homogeneous reaction. Let's say we have M moles of reactant A that reacts with B mole of reactant B, N mole, and the double arrow of course shows the reversible nature and forms X mole of C and Y mole of D. These are the reactants and these are the products. You can take any other particular equation as well. I just took a hypothetical equation here. Now this is a chemical reaction, and as you know from the state of chemical equilibrium, and as you solve many problems, we have the reactants in the beginning, and the rate of forward reaction is very fast. Okay? If I could again show you the nature of the reversible reaction to the graph. Now the y-axis is basically time axis. Time in seconds. Right? And the y-axis is a quantity or concentration, moles per unit. So I'm going to write that like this. Concentration. So in the beginning, we have just the reactants and we have no products. So for products, we will begin from here. Alright? So as the reaction proceeds, products continue to increase. Right? The concentration, as the time is going forward, the concentration of the products are increasing. And they increase. But after some time, this curve touched a plateau. A plateau too shows that the products were increasing rapidly in the beginning, but after some time, the concentration became constant. And for the reactors, the graph basically goes vertically downward, because they will start from the top because they are more important. And as time passes, the quantity of reactants will decrease, because in the beginning, foul will actually be dominant in this situation. This graph, this curve, comes down and also hits a plateau. Again, parallel, because the concentration are not changing. Why is that all the reactants, just like irreversible reactions, don't become products? And why does this happen? Because the products are also reacting and they are converting into the reactants. So somewhere here, the rate of the forward and the reaction and the reverse reaction equalize each other. And now these two plateaus are showing that the concentration of the reactants and products are not changing once the equilibrium is achieved, because the rate at which these two substances are reacting to form these two are also reacting to form one at the same rate. This is chemically equilibrium, right? After this, there is equilibrium. Chemical equilibrium was achieved. Now, in some reactions, the equilibrium will achieve quicker with a lot of reactions and less products. Sometimes more products, less reactants. Right? So this is the chemical equilibrium. I taught you this in the first lecture. Today I was to that one because of the right class, and you can see the how the graph works. Now once the equilibrium is achieved, this reaction, let us say, is in equilibrium, and equilibrium has been achieved. This reaction is supposed to be on a balance, right? This is a balance. This is a balance. The concentrations are not changing. Now, if you in this do some change to disturb the balance of this chemical equilibrium, how can you disturb the chemical equilibrium here? You can change few things. You can, number one, let's say, change the concentrations. Now by changing the concentrations, it means either you add the reactants or you add the product so that the balance is out. Right? This factor can disturb the balance of this chemical equilibrium. What else you can do to disturb the equilibrium? You can change the temperature. Because you know the equilibrium state, as you know from the data of equilibrium constant depends on the temperature, okay, not on the concentration. You increase concentration of products, it will also increase, the ratio will remain the same. So this is another factor which can disturb this balance. This equilibrium can be disturbed, and we want to disturb it. I'm sorry, disturb is a word normally used with a negative sense, but we actually want to disturb it because we don't want our reactants. We want to make sure that our reaction goes in forward direction only. So we will make use of these disturbances. You know, these are good disturbances in that case. Improvements, you can say. The third thing, which can disturb this balance, is if you change the pressure. If you change the pressure, that too will disturb this balance of this reaction. Okay, these are C, right, and G, the active mass, and this is A and B. Now, these three, the fourth factor which can disturb this equilibrium is using a catalyst, okay? If you use a catalyst, you know, a catalyst is a chemical substance which can alter the rate So these are the four factors which chemists will be using or chemists use to disturb the equilibrium into their favor. And by favor, I mean push the reaction in the forward direction. Alright? These are the changes in our textbook are called constraints. Constraints, which also means change. Our textbook also calls it stress. Now, I'm very sorry, the word disturbance, okay? The word constraint, the word stress, these are negative words. So don't think that the disturbance or constraint or stress is going to disturb the reaction and it's going to be unhappy. No, we don't want equilibrium. We want to push the reaction in the forward direction. So these are good disturbances, good stresses, and good constraints. Now, when we apply these constraints, the balance can be out. The concentrations which are plateaued right now, they will go up and down. And what do you think what we want? We want this plateau to go further down, right? Because we want to totally use up our reactors. And you want this plateau to curve up because we want more products. Both the reactors and products are homogeneous and they are present in the same beaker. Let's say same container. I will make a beaker for you here. So if you are thinking, or some of you think, that the reactors are in a separate container and the products are, no, they are in the same container. This one contains A, and B, it also contains C and D, hypothetical reaction. So, but inside them, their concentration are constant. There are still some reactants left. In some cases, for very small volume QC, more reactants are there, much more than the products. For a large volume QC, there are more products. Okay, and for moderate level of KC, there's a moderate balance in the concentration. Okay, do you want balance? No, you want more products. You want that they are the reactants completely diminish. So we can use the help of these changes to make sure we do that. All right. But what did the literature say? Henry Louis Chatelier basically studied the effect of these changes on a balance of chemical equilibrium. And he found something very interesting. And it was that if we change the balance by increasing the concentration of AB, like putting AB into the beaker, or by increasing the concentration of CD, like putting CD into the beaker, the chemical reaction, which was first at a balance, let's say, these two are balanced at plateau, they will move up and down so that they can regain the equilibrium. Like they want to come back to the place they were, right? So now you might be again thinking, if the equilibrium, if the Navigator's principle is telling us that equilibrium can be re-achieved, then what is the point of disturbing it? The point of disturbing the equilibrium is that when the equilibrium will try to regain its original state, it will definitely take one direction. Okay? Suppose if you have added AB, okay, and the AB are more than the equilibrium, then what's going to happen? The reaction will go in the forward direction so that it changes, decrease the constraint that you have applied on it. Your constraint is the addition of A and B, right? But how the reaction is responding, consuming AB and making more CD. And you don't want this, okay? If you add more CD, how will the reaction respond to it? It will consume CD and make more AB. We don't want AB, right? So, again, the constraint, concentration change, if applied to a balanced chemical equation or reaction equilibrium, the reaction will direct itself in such a way, if you add on the left side, reaction will tell its components, let's go towards the
right side. If you will add on to the right side, it will go and give you more to the left side. So which side do chemists want? Do they want the left side or do they want the right side? In this way, they want the right side. So we are going to change the concentration of AB, increase as much as we can, so that the reactions, the two reactions, power and reverse, the forward reaction is always predominant in this lesson. And you're getting more speed. So factor used, but we will go to the factors individually. Before I go there, we have to write a statement. What do we know? What is Lee Chatelier's principle? Lee Chatelier's principle states that if any stress or constraint is applied on a balanced chemical reaction, which means reaction at equilibrium for a long time, the reaction will shift its direction in such a way so it can undo the effect of that constraint. It will be much better if we write it. So I will take advantage and I'm gonna write. Because the statement in most examinations, we need to write the statements. So statements you can write for the Lee Chatelier's principle is, if any constraint, and by constraint we mean change. Constraint also means change or stress. If any constraint is applied to a balanced chemical reaction. Now by balanced, a reaction at equilibrium. Okay? Balanced chemical reaction, let us say at equilibrium. If a constraint, that change in concentration, change in temperature, change in pressure or catalyst is applied on a balanced chemical reaction, the chemical reaction will decide on what to do. Okay? And the reaction will proceed in such a direction or such a way so as to undo the effect of constraint. You can say nullify the constraint, you add AB, and now the reaction is asking the AB to react faster, to make more products, so they can again come back to equilibrium. So if the plateaus are going like that, and then you add AB, obviously this one goes high, this one goes low. They want to again come to a similar plateau, but to do so, only one reaction is going to be dominant, either forward or reverse. Depends on what side you have added. Right? So the chemical equilibrium is disturbed, but the chemical equilibrium reaction has a natural tendency to regain the equilibrium. And to regain the equilibrium, the chemical reaction should go in one direction. So if you are increasing on the left side, the reaction will try to go to the right side, but will go for what? To come back to where it was. Come back to a state where the rate of forward and reverse reaction equalize each other. So, if any constraint is applied to a balanced chemical reaction at equilibrium, the reaction will proceed in such a way so as to undo, nullify the effect of that constraint. This is the statement of Lee Chatelier's principle. Lee Chatelier, Henry Louis Chatelier, spent many years of his life to understand practically the effect of the constraint. Different constraints. He might have tried many more, but after his research, he found that these three are the major ones. So this is the statement of the Lee Chatelier.
You can write introduction like that, as I mentioned to you. Book can also help you. Then statement, and then we go towards individual stresses. So first here is the lesson concentration. Okay. So first is effect of change in concentration. What is going to happen when you change the concentration? Now, concentration are related very closely to, if you remember, applications of KC. KC can be used to direct to predict the direction of chemical reaction. So you know that KC is equal to product, right, upon reactants. The numerator is the products, okay, denominator is the if they are even so, if the product upon reactant at any time is same as the value of KC for that reaction, this is an equality. But if you add this equation, right, this is at equilibrium, which means the rate of forward and reverse reactions have equalized each other. Platoons are there. Now, if you add, let's say, the reactant, somehow you add the reactant, AB, like this is a vessel, and a vessel contains both the reactants and products, and then you have added the reactants, then this ratio will basically become less than KC. If you guys know, if you add denominator, the entire ratio will go less than KC. And you will see a condition like this. Product upon reactant. This ratio is going to be less than KC. Because you have added the reactants, okay? This is a factor. In such a case, if you add the reactants, like if you add the A and B, then the ratio will become less than KC, and this is the condition where the reaction goes in forward direction. If you remember from the application, it's going to go in the forward direction. And this is what the most favorable condition is. We want the reaction to go in forward direction only. We don't add the reactants to get the reactants back. So if you have a chemical reaction at equilibrium and that is in a balanced state, you will want to add more and more reactant all the time, so the ratio continues to be less than KC. And in this case, you have more reactant than products. They will convert into products to come back to this condition, right? And if you add the products, we do the reverse stuff, okay? If you add the products, then obviously the products will become more and the ratio will exceed the actual value of KC. Now, I remember some students asked me on WhatsApp that in the chart there are four different values. They are different values for the same reaction, and the 4.03, 3.99, they are the same value by that. So, 4 is the value of the acidification. So, if you add the products and your ratio goes more than KC, then it must come down. Come down means product must consume to make reactants. That's the reverse direction, right? This is a reverse direction. So I hope you understood the effect of changing concentration. If you add the concentration of the reactants, you push the reaction to the forward direction because you are making this condition. And the reaction will react more to produce products more and to reach this state where they won't get equal. So if you add AB, it will go towards more CD. If you add CD, it will go
what word, more able somehow to destroy the effect of constraint. But what is our advantage? We can use this behavior of a reversible reaction to our advantage. That if we have two reactors, let's say A, B, and B is cheaper than that, okay? Let me give you an example here. Nitrogen gas is obviously expensive than hydrogen gas. And they make us NH3 ammonia. It's a very important chemical substance. Now, this one, this guy, is cheaply available as compared to nitrogen. So if in the reaction you pump hydrogen all the time, but technically it is like if you keep on adding hydrogen throughout the reaction, what it's going to do, you will suppress the reverse reaction. You will make more and more ammonia by adding this. If you add both more hydrogen and hydrogen together, it's also good for you. You can get more products. But for a manufacturer, when we want to decrease the cost, adding a cheaper reactor will really help us push the direction in a forward direction, getting more products at less cost. This is the advantage and application of lithium-based principle in the industry, because ammonia is industry important. All right? I hope it's clear for you how the concentration affects the balance. The second one, my friends, is the temperature. What? Effect of change in temperature. To understand this effect of change in temperature. To understand this effect, my friends, I must first tell you how is temperature involved. There are two types of reaction in chemistry, everybody knows. One are called endothermic reactions. Do you know? Endothermic reactions. Now let's discuss them one by one. First endothermic, then exothermic. Indeed, these reactions are those in which the reactants need energy, let's say heat, to convert into products. Okay, so the heat is a reactant. Okay, sometimes this is also expressed as A plus B and arrow C plus D, and then delta H is positive. Now, writing this heat on the reactant side basically means that this is positive, this is most commonly used way for representing the endothermic reactions. And but this one I wrote, this is the same, because the heat being positive means the heat is added to the reactants to make the products. Now, what do you want to do? If you want to make products, if you use this thing in mind, treat heat as a concentration factor, which is helping the reactors. What do you think? Should we increase the temperature for such reactions? Yes, because heat is a cheaper reactant. If you increase the temperature for such reactions, increase in temperature. If you increase temperature, you basically are helping the reactors to absorb more energy. Reactants only react when they absorb energy. You can write like this or like this. Reactants only react when they gain the energy. So if you are giving more energy, you are giving more reactors. You are giving more chance to react. In this way, what's going to happen? You get more products. Alright? Increasing temperature will push the reaction in forward direction. Better, we want it. So, and you decrease the reaction, you mean if you decrease the heat, you are decreasing the reactors, helping the products to dominate. So, if you decrease temperature, what are you doing by decreasing temperature? You are basically allowing your products to dominate onto the reactors, and you are going to get a reverse. first direction. So guys, if you are working as a chemist in an industry and your manufacturer wants you to get more products and less reactants, and if your heat is endothermic, what are you going to do? Are you going to decrease temperature? No. You're going to increase temperature so that you're more. If you want to express this in terms of this and treat heat as a reactant, so increasing heat will give you this condition. The ratio will become less than Kc, or Kc will become higher, more than the ratio. Okay? If you increase temperature, because the heat is at the denominator side, you will have this. This ball will support this. And if you decrease the heat, then you are letting the products get more, then the ratio of the heat per quadrant will become more than Kc, and this will go to support this, like I mentioned here. In both cases, they will reach this, because reversibly, all reversible reactions want to reach to this condition, where the ratio is the same as the radio. This is equilibrium. So my dear friends, this ability of a chemical reaction to gain back the balance or try to undo the effect of the constraint, if I can highlight this, undo the effect of the constraint, this behavior of a reversible reaction helps us push the reaction in one direction. So if you want more products, please increase them. And if you want more reactants, you don't want it, but this is possible. Sometimes you want it. So this is the effect number two, effect of concentration change. The third here is pressure. What is that? Effect of pressure change. Effect of change in pressure. Now this effect only blooms when you have a gaseous equilibrium. It has no value in a solid or liquid equilibrium, okay? Because pressure is what can be applied on gases mainly. So if you have a gaseous reaction, then this can help. And again, there are three conditions, okay? You can write that changes in pressure affect only the gaseous equilibrium. Only affect gaseous equilibriums. Right? Because gases can take the pressure. But all the gases are present in the same container. So if you apply pressure, the gas will be in and some are not. Let me explain to you. That's three cases. Case number one, just look here. You take, you know how iodide can decompose to hydrogen and iodine. You all know this? These are two volumes of HI, and one, two volumes on this side as well. So both sides have equal volumes. You can do this, here Kb is equal to Kc. If you guys remember, when the m plus n equals to x plus 5. This is called m plus n. Remember, you've done it. This is called x plus 5. So in this case, m plus n is equal to x plus 1. So both reactant and products have the similar volumes. If you increase pressure, both of them get the equal pressure. If you decrease pressure, both of them get the equal effect. So no change. Yes? No change. There's no change. Increase in pressure, no change in the balance. The increase in pressure or decrease in pressure is not going to affect those chemical reactions in which the volumes on reactant and product sides are equal, or for which Kb equals to Kc. When we go towards case number two, that will be interesting for you. Let's say when the volumes are not equal. Let me show this one. Let's say the they form 2SO3. Now if you count it, 2 volume and 1 volume, that is 3 volumes. Alright? And this is just 2 volumes. Now the volumes in the same container, if you have all these 3, and then this side has more volume, and you increase pressure, you are basically pressing the SO2 and O2 and causing them more than you're causing to SO2. So in this case, you know, the Kp basically is less than Kc, if you guys remember it from the previous lecture. Because from here, the M plus N is more than X plus Y, or the volumes are decreasing. For such reactions, Kp is less than Kc, and increasing pressure will favor the forward direction. So, because if you beat up the more volumes more. So, if you want to do an increase in pressure, you will push the reaction in forward direction. Now, some students might think that we will control whether we want to press them or them. No, when we increase pressure, all of them get pressed because all of them are in the same container. But only those reactants, those that are pressed more, which are in the natural volume. So increase pressure, they will get the beta, they will convert it into the SO2, and we want it. If you decrease the pressure, decrease in pressure. Guys, this is not good. Because decreasing pressure will give them some legs. They will expand away from each other. And when they go away from each other, they won't collide. No collision, no reaction, no particles. And you're going in a reverse direction. That's why in the industry, you know, there are large containers or cylinders to have high pressure. Mostly they have high pressure to cause more and more reactants to bounce into each other, react and make more problems. So I hope you got it. For those reaction where Kp is less than Kc, a higher pressure is recommended. Okay? Now last but not the least is case 3, if the volumes are more on this side. Okay, what's going to happen? Let's say we take this reaction where ammonia decomposes into hydrogen and nitrogen. Guys, you know, this is 2 volumes, this is 2 and 1, 3 volumes. Okay, it's different from that one. For this reaction, Kp is more than Kc because M plus N is less than X plus Y. Now, if you increase pressure, who are you going to push more? Ammonia. This side, sorry. The products are going to push more. And they will then go towards the left side. We don't want it. So, if you increase the pressure, remember, all these things are in the same container. And increase the pressure will affect the reactants much less than it will affect the product. So you will have a backward or a reverse direction. And in the end, you will get more reactants. So, but that's not recommended. What is the recommended technique? You should decrease it. If the products decrease pressure, if the products are expanding, give them more space. They can take more space and not react back. Only this way you can push the reaction towards the forward direction to get more nitrogen and hydrogen. But these are well explained in our textbook in some charts. So I would recommend you to make those charts in the textbook and then show to me tonight or tomorrow. I'm not seeing your homework that nicely as I should because it's too much of homework. But I will definitely see sooner or later, so you don't worry about that, keep sending me. The third and last is that using a catalyst. Now, catalyst increases or decreases the rate. So if it's a reversible reaction, it will affect both rates. So generally, not that much effect. With this, our lecture ends. It's a pretty long lecture. So I would recommend you to take 2 days. This is your 2 days dosage, okay? Today you understand it, read from the book, spend time, research on it, all these factors, don't
just research on it, more and more, more examples, more equations, maybe ask Google, maybe YouTube, other videos as well, and then tomorrow you better fail it. So this work, lecture 7, is for Tuesday and also for Wednesday. Thank you so much, have a good time. Bye-bye.